الحمد لله رب العالمين. O believers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الله سبحانه وتعالى, all gratitude must be to the one deserving of gratitude, Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We are believers. We live in the world of asbab, so we must do, world of cause and effect. We must do, but we don't rely on asbab. We rely on Rabbul Asbab. We rely on the one who makes the cause and effect. So your rizq, your health, all favors that you are experiencing in life may come, your rizq may come from your job, through your job, but the one who is actually dispensing it to you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who's creating the cause and effect for you to get your rizq is Allah. So one must never be consumed by the ni'mah, by the favor, and forget the mun'im, the one who gives the favor. This is important, because this world is the world of trials. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are mubtaleen, we are tried with things like this. We are tried with favors. We are tried from Allah keeping or holding back the favors. We are tried with our people around us, with choices we have to make. And the way of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he showed us that even for the prophets, even for Ashab al-Nabi, even for Awliya, that the way was treacherous, difficult. The more what you're asking for, the preciousness of what you're seeking, to attain that, the harder the way. And the higher Allah has bestowed favors on you, the more Allah has bestowed favors on you, then it comes with difficulties in this earth. And that's hadith al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ ابْتِلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. The most afflicted human beings are the prophets. The prophets are the highest of Allah's creation in stations, in grants, in belief, in knowledge. Say what you want. And the most afflicted amongst creation. ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ. Then, like this, every time you go one layer, Ashab al-Nabi, for example, then Tabi'een, or Anbiya, the inheritors of Anbiya, Awliya, like that. The higher the rank, the higher the grants, the more difficult this world becomes. Because they can carry also. Allah gives them the ability. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. So we come upon now, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, an occasion of Ashura. And this, as we were told, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went to Medina, he saw the Jews fasting. He said, why are they fasting? They said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivered Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam from his enemies, from Fir'aun, on this day. The sea opened. We all know the story of what happened. So it is a day of deliverance. It's a day of victory of Allah's servants over the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The story of Sayyidina Musa and the sacrifices he had to endure, him and his followers, with Fir'aun. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory on this day to them. That's how special this day is that is coming, I believe, Tuesday, the 16th. So, Ahlullah, the people who know, they take advantage of these times. They fast on this day because Prophet ﷺ, أحتسب على الله, in a hadith, أن يكفر به السنة الماضية, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive the sins of the previous year, one day of fasting. And he said, if I live till next year, I will not مخالفة اليهود not to follow our previous followers of Sayyidina Musa, the Yahud not to follow their example in step by step. He said, I will fast the day before and in some narrations the day after. And our Mashaykh, if you can fast all 3 days in this month, Muharram, Prophet ﷺ indicated that the best fast after Ramadan is Muharram. So if we can fast more in this month, it's better, inshallah. So there are things also, there's a hadith that they deem da'if, but throughout the ages, the ummah practiced this sunnah, this way, is tawsi' ala al-a'ila. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, man wassa'a Allahu ala ayali. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying that whoever, aw kama qala an-nabi, whoever spends generously on his family on Ashura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him rizq for the entire year, will make his rizq wasi' for the entire year. Even they took also to do all the sunan, if one can, like kuhl, like cutting one's nails, showering, all that on a special day like this is important. And the other aspect of this day that comes around every time is the sacrifices of Ahlul Bayt and Sayyidina Hussein and his family, which is not isolated. Yani the sacrifices of Sayyidina Hussein came on the heels of many sacrifices of Ahlul Bayt. It's not exceptional by any way that this is an isolated incident where one big name from Ahlul Bayt, like Sayyidina al-Husayn, Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, alayhi salam, radiyallahu anhu. No, before him, his grandfather, his Sayyidina Hamza, Sayyidina Ali, Sayyidina al-Hasan, they paved the way for this ummah to receive its religion the way Prophet ﷺ intended it to be, through their sacrifices. So it's a day that we remember the sacrifices of Ahlul Bayt, but we don't transgress the limits of manners in doing so. There, Sayyidina Ali, before Sayyidina Hussein, was martyred, was killed while praying on Jum'ah in his minbar. And he is Aliyun, ana madinat al-ilmi wa Aliyun babuha. He is who he is. Huh? He is the one who is carrying the progeny of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who was raised in his kanaf, in his hijr, under his gaze, radiyallahu anhu wa arda. The one who used to say, saluni qabla an tafqiduni. Ask me anything before you lose me. Ilm, nobility, Sayyidina Ali, born inside the Kaaba, and he was killed by the Ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by members of the Ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad on his sajda, praying on Friday. Sayyidina al-Hasan sacrificed, had the opportunity to be the Imam of the Muslims. He had he's labeled even al-Khalifa al-Khamis. As Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, that Khilafa al-Rashida is 30 years. The guided Khilafa after Prophet is 30 years. And if you add up to Sayyidina Ali's martyrdom, it's 29 years and 6 months. And the 6 months of Sayyidina al-Hasan completed the 30 years of Khilafa Rashid. That's why he is labeled as Al-Khalifa Al-Khamis. And what did he do? He had mulk. He had bay'ah of all the Aqtar, Masr, Iraq, everyone gave him bay'ah in the Muslim world except Sham. And what did he do? He saw that the blood of Muslims will be spilled, and he said, take it. Take the mulk. إن هذا ابني سيد يصلح الله به بين فئتين عظيمتين من المسلمين. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم indicated, predicted, saw that his son سيدنا الحسن will be the one who makes peace between two great groups of Muslims. Why is this important to understand? Because some people use this incident with Sayyidina al-Husayn as something to hang fitna between the Muslims. No. The sacrifices of Sayyidina al-Hasan was poisoned. And he struggled with pain for a long time before he left dunya. Sacrifice. His sacrifices are less in any way than the sacrifices of Sayyidina al-Husayn. Sayyidina Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, knowingly taking his whole family with him, knowing that these people mean him no good, even after being advised. Why they do these things? Why the sacrifices? Because they chose Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they were raised by Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because they are talamidu Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are inheritors of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whenever they're faced with a choice, regardless of the sacrifices, they are going to choose what Allah likes. Teaching us. And today, تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ. This is a nation, these nations have done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought them in this world, tried them, they reached what they reached, and now they're with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now it's our time. It's our turn. This is our time to be tried. In our lives, people sit sometimes and they bring the mention of Sayyidina al-Husayn's incident and who is with Husayn alayhi salam and who isn't with Husayn alayhi salam. The question is, forget sacrifices of supporting the grandson of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's a huge thing, huh? In your daily life, if we are faced with choices, simple choices, where you may lose something dear of dunya, where you may have to sacrifice something dear, what would you choose? Would you choose haqq? Even though you're going to lose? So before we even go that far, are we haqqani? Are we choosing righteousness and truthfulness and honesty and generosity and selflessness over selfishness, over what I like and I don't like? Are we choosing what Allah likes? So you think if we are tested the way these people were tested back then, what choices we would make? These people, they wrote to Sayyidina al-Husayn, come. Come, we are supporting you. We love you. We love Ahlul Bayt. Thousands and thousands of letters. Come. We have armies waiting to support you. And when they are tested, when it was their neck or the grandson of Sayyidina Muhammad's neck on the scale, what happened? Some of them were fighting in that army while crying. May Allah not test us. We are weak ones, Sidi. But we have to make things relevant to our time. Let us start with small steps. This is the beginning of the year. Let us start, make intention to be a truthful person, honest, in jad and in hazal, whether in seriousness or in jest and joking. Let's try to be like that the whole year, to be truthful, to speak the truth, to choose what is truthful. And then, حاسبوا أنفسكم, at the end of the year, may come and say, was I truthful? Did I make all the right choices? قولوا قولي هذا واستغفروا الله لي ولكم فيفوز المستغفرين.